All right, secret number five, routine labs are not adequate if we're gonna stamp out heart disease number one in America. Just one of many research studies that says, although LDL cholesterol is a risk factor for developing premature atherosclerosis and heart attacks, of a massive amount of people that were admitted to a hospital with coronary artery disease syndromes, most of them did not have a cholesterol of 400 and an LDL cholesterol of 250. Most had average American LDL cholesterols, 120, 125, 118, sometimes 98. And yet they still have heart disease. That doesn't mean cholesterol doesn't matter. Oh, cholesterol matters so much. You know, it just isn't a one-to-one prediction that those with the highest always have the most disease, but it's a factor. But there's got to be more going on than just LDL cholesterol. Truly, we know the healthiest LDL cholesterol is 50 or 60, maybe even lower. There are wild native populations that large number of people have LDL cholesterols of 40 or 50 or even less. And now with medication, we do it all the time in the world of cardiology. I had a patient today, LDL cholesterol of 28 because diet and medication. I'm going to leave it there. He spent about 65 years with his LDL cholesterol at 180. A few years at 28 is going to help him. All right. Why is LDL cholesterol not the only thing? And why do you need advanced labs? I love this graphic. It's about 10 years old from a vitamin company, but there's many these daggers that are into an artery causing arterial disease. Maybe you've heard of homocysteine. That's not a wildly common, but still an important factor for artery disease. That's one of the knives on the right. Maybe you've heard of fibrinogen, a clotting factor. It's important. Maybe you've heard of low vitamin K. That's one of the knives up above. Have you ever eaten natto or natto beans? Perhaps you're taking a supplement with vitamin K2. Of course, vitamin K1 comes from leafy greens. That's a lot easier. How about inadequate nitric oxide? Something you can actually measure via a blood test called asymmetric dimethyl arginine, ADMA, or nitric oxide salivary test strips. You can actually measure for these things. So, action step, please don't be a statistic. Get advanced labs, and I'm going to show you this graphic again in a moment, but get advanced labs. You may have to pay for them on your own. There are companies that I have no interest, like lifeextension.com, FX Wellness, and others, Labs Anywhere, and you can check off the labs you want. You might spend $250, $300. If you're working with a doctor that understands these labs, I've ordered all these labs thousands of times on thousands of patients, and they do have coverage in most cases, so it works out well. You also can negotiate a price with a lab like LabCorp or Quest and really get quite a low cost for these. So although this is not as clear cut, secret number six is I'm gonna dive for a few minutes into some old and new data on inflammation, but I wanna spend a little time. This is a blood vessel going from clean on one side to clogged with a blood clot. And we know that inflammation, the flame, the fire, comes from a Latin word, e-igniti, ignite the disease in the arteries, that we have advanced ways to measure it. It says there, and I apologize, I'll read it for you, F2 isoprostanes. That's a urine test. You just urinate in a cup, and we get measures of what's called oxidative stress. You, of course, know all about antioxidants. Well, you can measure if that balance in your body is working. Oxidized LDL, that's like the rusting of your LDL. And that is perhaps the most dangerous form of LDL because of easy uptake through the endothelium, creating the nidus for plaque. But you can measure it and you can improve upon it. ADMA, I mentioned that. That's a way to assess nitric oxide production. It's a blood test. Microalbumin, that is an inexpensive urine test that in a recent paper 2 weeks ago, a systematic review predicts death, predicts heart attack, predicts lifespan. For a few cents, you get a urine test that tells you all of that. HSC reactive protein, high sensitivity. We're going to talk about that. LPPLA2 used to be called the plaque test. It's an enzyme in the wall of an artery. You don't want it elevated. And myeloperoxidase is a Cleveland Clinic patented blood test are the white cells in the plaques of your arteries overactive? And if they are, you better get on a lifestyle program to bring that marker called MPO, myeloperoxidase. And the good news is the patients I test where these are off and I retest, they dramatically improve. They are variable. Well, what have we learned about inflammation? Because in fact, 150 years ago, it was proposed that inflammation was a big deal in heart disease, but can we possibly conclude that this is really the real deal? So there is a physician at Harvard, Paul Ridker. Those of us in the cardiology and academic world know his name for sure, but those of you not in that world might not. And he has spent 20 plus years focused on the idea that if we had therapies for inflammation, we could move the needle forward in heart disease as we've had therapies for cholesterol and blood pressure and blood sugar. So he got approval for a massive study. It's a little sciencey, I apologize. I want to show it to you just to prove the point. Inflammation is something you should be discussing and testing and correcting. The study was called CANTOS, and the drug, I'll give it a try, canakinumab, was a drug you've never heard of, and you'll never hear about it unless it is approved as a cancer drug. But it was selected in a fascinating study published in 2017. What was the question? The question was, here's a study back in 1997. If you're an apparently healthy man and you get your blood measured for C-reactive protein, a blood test for inflammation, if you look at the black bars below, the higher your level of C-reactive protein, the higher is your risk of a heart attack. But is this just because the cholesterol's up and it's just another way to say your cholesterol's off? Or is inflammation its own unique risk? This study in 1997 with Paul Ridker, the first author, couldn't prove that. So he proposed this concept. If you look over at the blue figure to the left that says residual cholesterol risk, cardiologists right now are excited. We have more and more ways to lower cholesterol. And if you've had a heart attack and your LDL cholesterol, like it shows here, is 110, we're going to go for much lower, 60, 55, 50 in many cases. That's unmet residual cholesterol risk. But go over to the right, residual inflammatory risk. What if your C-reactive protein is up? Do we bother with it? Do we even measure it? Do we comment with it? Well, until this 2017 study, we had no real proof that bothering with it could make a difference in outcome. So Dr. Ridker studied, and boy, is this busy science. And if you notice, there's a picture of a liver, and to the right is CRP, this marker of inflammation we've been talking about. It's not just a marker, it's actually also part of atherosclerosis. And he found a drug that was available that interfered with the production of C-reactive protein. It was made, if I recall, by Novartis. It was a very rarely used drug. But what's amazing, if you look at the upper box on the right, he organized a randomized study of 10,000 people who had had a history of a heart attack. They were on very good medication, but their high sensitivity C-reactive protein was elevated. And he set up a study done all over the world, many, many test centers, where some people got a placebo and 3/4 of the group got different doses of this drug that was an orphan drug, but lowers C-reactive protein. It was a perfect study. If you lower inflammation and you leave cholesterol alone, you make a difference. And if you look at this, it's pretty cool. The bottom three lines, what happens to your LDL, your HDL, and your triglyceride cholesterols if you get on this experimental drug? Nothing. It's not a cholesterol drug. But if you look at the top, what happens to your C-reactive protein on this drug? The placebo dropped a little. Maybe people just ate a little healthier because they were in a research study for 48 months. But if they were on the actual drug tested, they had a major drop in C-reactive protein up to 65 to 70%. Really cool stuff. And this is what was shown. The blue line are bad things that happened to people that had a previous heart attack when they were on the injectable research drug. And the gray line is the placebo. which line would you rather be on? You want to be on the lower line, major adverse cardiac events. So he was able to show if we don't touch your cholesterol, but we lower your C-reactive protein with a pharmacologic drug, we can make a difference in the chance you're going to show up with a heart attack, a stroke, a recurrent need for stent or bypass, or die. So the point was made, inflammation matters, not just in theory, but in practice. But what do we do about it? How do we handle it? A lot of you are already saying turmeric, beets, greens, nuts, and seeds. And the answer is true. An anti-inflammatory diet is a very strong factor we should all emphasize, of course. I want to show you here, the top part of this is about the study I just presented to you. A 15 to 17% reduction in bad things. And if you see the arrow, by lowering high sensitivity C-reactive protein. The problem was this drug will not be commercialized for heart disease. It's wildly expensive and it has toxicity. So a lot of us were excited when within about a year, a second study was concluded using methotrexate, an anti-inflammatory drug that's often used in autoimmune diseases, very inexpensive, decades of experience. We were hopeful maybe the new heart drug was going to be methotrexate. Well, it turns out methotrexate doesn't do much to lower high sensitivity C-reactive protein, and this study proved to be a bust. Cardiologists are not talking about methotrexate right now after a heart attack or in chronic heart disease. But we are hopeful again in 2021 that we not only know how important inflammation is, and we certainly know how important lifestyle is, but two studies have been published in the last year. I'm only going to show you one. These were people with chronic heart disease. Maybe 2 years ago, they had a heart attack or a stent or a bypass. They weren't in an emergency room. They either got an old drug for gout, an anti-inflammatory gout drug called colchicine. We usually use it acutely if somebody has a gouty toe that hurts as much as any disease can be. They got 0.5 milligrams or they got a placebo, and that was continued for 2 to 3 years. And they actually found 5,222 people to be involved in this study. This is amazing. This is called Ladoco 2 trial. And if you look at the bars that are there with the numbers 9.6 versus 6.8, if you were on the placebo over the subsequent couple of years, you had about a 10% chance of having a bad event. If you were on colchicine, that's a gout drug, but we're using it here as an anti-inflammatory, it reduced by about a third the risk that you're going to have a bad event. Now, there was a second study in people that were within 30 days of a heart attack, just as many people in that study, same setup, colchicine or placebo. That's called Colcat, and that showed the same events. So right now, as the check mark says, if you look down there, published in August 2020, patients who received an anti-inflammatory called colchicine had a lower risk of bad heart events, although we, in the short follow-up, hadn't impacted overall death rates yet. Inflammation matters. If you want to control inflammation with a low processed food, high whole food plant diet with lots of spices, garlic, onion, ginger, turmeric, go for it. If you're actually a heart patient, you might do that and ask your cardiologist about another secret using colchicine in chronic heart disease. Very, very cool and hopeful stuff. So, action step, get tested for inflammation. If you are elevated, get retested after you make some changes. Are you getting enough omega-3 in your diet? Hemp hearts, my favorite. Chia seeds, flax seeds, sources of omega-3 that are anti-inflammatory. Ginger, garlic, turmeric, boswellia. What's your waistline? Are you snoring at night and need a sleep study at home? Get tested. Do you have psoriasis? And maybe you want to do a hyper-nourishing program for psoriasis using massive amounts of plant-based omega-3 and green smoothies, has been popularized by Dr. Brooke Goldner. Get tested, get retested.